On May 6, 1968, above Ellington Air Force Base, a strange skeletal machine hangs in the air. It looks more like a construction scaffold than a spacecraft. For a moment, it hovers, wobbling under its jet engine. Inside, a hero of American aviation grips the controls, facing NASA's deadliest aircraft. He's flown it dozens of times, but today, without warning, the control thrusters die. The vehicle lurches violently, spinning, tilting, and pitching toward the ground. The pilot has only seconds to act, eject and lose the craft, or stay and risk becoming his first fatality. In that impossible moment, what he decides will determine whether NASA's most experienced test pilot survives to command the mission that puts the first humans on the moon. Before astronauts could land on the moon, they had to learn to fly a spacecraft in a gravity 1/6 that of Earth. Meeting this unprecedented challenge was only made more urgent when, after his election, President John F. Kennedy delivered the audacious goal of landing a man on the moon. NASA now faced a monumental question. How could humans be trained to perform a maneuver that had never been attempted in an environment that could not be replicated on Earth? In 1961, engineers set to work designing a machine that could complement vertical landing trials with helicopter and ground-based simulators, giving astronauts hands-on experience with a free-flying craft that closely resembled the lunar module. What resulted was a machine with a spindly aluminum frame, almost skeletal in appearance, bristling with thrusters and jets. The entire craft looked like a cross between a scaffold, a biplane, and a carnival ride. But despite its odd frame that granted it the nickname of Flying Bedstead, it performed maneuvers no ordinary aircraft could hope to achieve. At the heart of it, a single turbofan engine provided lift equal to 5/6 of the vehicle's total weight, effectively canceling out most of Earth's gravity. This left the pilot responsible for controlling only the remaining 1/6 of the vehicle's weight, simulating the moon's reduced gravity, forcing the astronaut to fly a craft that felt as if it were drifting above the lunar surface. Bell Aerosystems in Buffalo, New York, built the first LLRVs, using analog fly-by-wire computers to convert a pilot's movements into electronic commands, a system that would help pave the way for digital fly-by-wire technology in later aircraft. Every component and electronic system was among the most advanced of the 1960s, ensuring the craft behaved as closely as possible to the real lunar module. Ground simulators could replicate controls, but until now, nothing could prepare astronauts for the challenge of guiding a vehicle through precise maneuvers and soft landings under reduced gravity. LLRV-1 arrived at NASA's Flight Research Center in April 1964, while LLRV-2 reached the site in pieces. Concerned about potential cost overruns, FRC Director Paul Bickel had the second vehicle assembled and tested on site. Before taking to the skies, LLRV-1 was first readied on a tilt table, designed to evaluate engine operations without actual flight. Once these preliminary tests were complete, attention shifted to the old South Base area of Edwards Air Force Base, where full flight testing would begin. The first test flights took place on October 30, 1964. Senior test pilot Joe Walker climbed into the skeletal frame, throttled up the turbofan, and lifted the flying bedstead off the ground. Other pilots joined the rotation by December. Don Malik, another FRC research pilot, took the controls, while Army helicopter test pilot Jack Kluver adapted his rotorcraft instincts to lunar simulated free flight. NASA's own Joseph Algrante and H.E. Ream alternated in the cockpit, executing steep climbs, tight turns, and rapid thruster corrections, pushing the LLRV to its mechanical and aerodynamic limits with each flight. As November 1966 reached its end, after 198 flights of LLRV-1 and 6 of LLRV-2, Edwards had confirmed the machine's utility. Vehicle 1 shipped to Houston in December 1966, followed by 2 in January 1967. By the time Neil Armstrong made his first LLRV-1 flight on March 27, 1967, at Ellington Air Force Base, cockpit modifications had added a three-axis hand controller, throttle, and a styrofoam enclosure restricting the pilot's view to mimic the lunar module's cramped interior. The real challenge lay in the controls. The hand controller managed pitch, roll, and yaw. The throttle-adjusted turbofan lift. Hydrogen peroxide thrusters, fed by a helium system, required rapid, precise bursts to stabilize the vehicle. Near-instantaneous responses punished overcorrections or mistimed inputs. Feedback was entirely mechanical and analog. Pilot skill, reflexes, and nerves were the only safeguards. After the tests, Armstrong, Algranti, and Rehm noted that in a serious control failure, the vehicle's 500-foot ceiling left ejection as the only option for survival. On May 6, 1968, Neil Armstrong, the backup commander for the Apollo 9 mission, climbed into the LLRV-1, strapped into its ejection seat, and gripped the controls. He'd flown this mission dozens of times before. A small crowd of engineers and fellow astronauts in Ellington Air Force Base watched from a safe distance. The GECF 700 turbofan roared to life, lifting the LLRV. Hydrogen peroxide thrusters fired in rapid, precise bursts, adjusting pitch, yaw, and roll, keeping the fragile balance of lunar gravity in check. Then, without warning, responses become sluggish, and movements were jerky. The LLRV hesitated in midair, struggling to stay balanced. Armstrong's hands moved quickly over the controls. His instincts took over. He yanked the ejection handle, and the seat shot him upward, slamming him with a sudden 14 Gs in just half a second. The parachute opened immediately, catching him and slowing his fall, leaving him dangling safely above the ground. Below him, the LLRV crashed under the tarmac, and pieces of the vehicle scattered in every direction. Manned Space Flight Center Director Robert L. Gulrath wasted no time in initiating a detailed inquiry into the accident. The task fell to Joseph Algranti, Chief of Aircraft Operations, a pilot who knew the LLRV intimately, given that he's flown it himself many times. His analysis revealed the root cause to be a drop in helium pressure, feeding the hydrogen peroxide altitude thrusters. This seemingly minor pressure loss starved the thrusters of fuel, leaving the vehicle unable to maintain orientation. High winds at the time further exacerbated the problem, making control nearly impossible. Compounding the danger, the LLRV's instruments had not sounded a warning, making the failure invisible until the vehicle began pitching uncontrollably. The board determined the fuel completion for the altitude thrusters, combined with environmental factors, made the accident almost unavoidable under the conditions. Only Armstrong's rapid ejection had prevented disaster. As a result, JSC management decided to terminate further LLRV flights. The first lunar landing training vehicle was about to be shipped from Bell to Ellington Air Force Base for ground and flight testing, signaling the transition to a safer, more refined training platform. On the human side, Armstrong's accident didn't deter him at all. After ejecting and narrowly avoiding the ball of flames, he returned to the office, finished out his workday, and went home as if nothing had happened. Not only that, but before going on his space mission, he flew the practice simulator 12 more times. Negotiations with Bell Air Systems for three LLTVs began in October, culminating in a $5.9 million contract in March 1967. The first LLTV arrived at Ellington Air Force Base in June 1968, ready for ground checks and flight testing by the Johnson Space Center's Aircraft Operations Division, led by Joseph Algranti. Algranti took the cockpit in August 1968, initiating the first flights of the new trainer. He pushed the LLTV hard, exploring its flight envelope, testing its throttle, altitude thrusters, and aerodynamic limits. On December 8th, disaster nearly struck once more. While expanding the LLTV's speed envelope, Algranti's craft became uncontrollable. The yaw thrusters were overpowered by aerodynamic forces, a vulnerability amplified by the styrofoam cockpit enclosure. With barely 3/5 of a second to react, Algranti ejected safely, the vehicle exploding beneath him. A subsequent investigation highlighted the risks. Cost constraints had prevented wind tunnel testing, leaving flight tests as the primary evaluation method. LLTV-3 was shipped to Langley Research Center for full-scale wind tunnel tests, revealing that the cockpit enclosure created a yawing force that exceeded thruster capacity. By March 1969, a high-level LLTV Flight Readiness Review Board approved the LLTV-2 for flight again. 18 successful flights later, Armstrong completed his LLTV training just a month before Apollo 11. He would later reflect that the lunar module, quote, flew very much like the LLTV, giving me a good deal of confidence, a comfortable familiarity. Although LLTV-2 was destroyed in 1971 during a computer system test, its pilot ejected safely, and LLTV-3 survived, eventually becoming the training platform for Apollo 17, and now a museum piece at Johnson Space Center.